started this year, the first Sunday, and that will be, God will do a new thing. Tell somebody, God will do a new thing. God is not a man that will lie. He's not the son of man, and you should be repenting. So it's good to do a new thing in your life. New is good. You like new? I love new things. You are a new creation. Your DNA is so unique. Even for the identical twins that possibly have the same DNA, their fingerprints are not the same. So if you tell me, oh, I have a twin brother or a twin sister, I want to tell you that your fingerprints are not the same. So you are unique. Your thumbprint is special. It's unique. So God has a purpose for your life. You are born original. You are not a copy. So keep living as original. You have an assignment. You have a purpose for coming here. And God is saying today that He's going to redeem all your time. Amen. Even all that has been wasted, He will redeem everything.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Make your mark. Psalm 139 verse 14, He says, I will praise you for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You are fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen.
Make a mark. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My soul knows that your works are marvelous. This is your season, it's your year. There's an excitement in my spirit that God is about to do something in your life.
Amen.
This is your season, the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Don't settle for down where you can be on the top. Today I want to encourage you, I'm here to encourage you that you don't want to settle right in the valley, where you can attain the mountain top. This is your season. Just accept it. You have to receive it. Before you can receive this, you must believe it. And when you receive it, you must accept it to demonstrate it. It's your season. I am telling you, this is your time. I want you to dwell in that. God is about to do a new thing in your life. You must not die as a copy. Be original. That thing that God designed you to do, manifest this, and God is going to continue to renew your strength in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Please follow your path. Follow with your strength. Follow your destiny with your strength. You have so much of potential. Release these potentials into life. This world needs you. It needs your wisdom. They need your knowledge. They need you to add to the flavor of this life. Don't just sit down there and think you are nothing. You are something. God made you to do something, and you must fulfill that assignment. The mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
And He's about to do something new in your life. Today I'm here to encourage you. I'm here to let you know that God is on the throne. He will do that new thing in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Do not believe the devil at all. What you think reflects what you believe. So begin to think begin to think that God is going to do it. And when those new things are coming, begin to demonstrate them, begin to enjoy them.
Amen.
And begin to live in that path, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
You are created to run and dream dreams. You are created for a purpose. You are created, something is in you. You know what? God is right in you. You carry Him around. The strength of God is in your life. So don't let somebody tell you you cannot do it or that God is not going to do something new. He's going to do something new.
Amen.
I am telling you, I have the conviction in me that I am special. What about you? You are here for a purpose. You are a shine of destiny. So you must attain your destiny. You must attain your purpose. You must attain why you are here. That assignment you must do it. Your conception, path, and life are part of divine engagement. They are part of God's plan. Your conception, your birth, your being here, these are part of God's design engagement. Don't you think it's important that you are here? Being in America is not an accident, brethren. It's not an accident. God has an assignment for you to be in this country. You must not live here until you fulfill that assignment.
Amen.
You are so necessary in God's master plan. God needs you. Even this church needs you.
Amen.
This church needs you.
Amen.
Do not allow people will just shut you down and say, you are not important. Who is listening to you? People used to say back, oh, if people say anything like that, when people are discussing and you said you have an idea, you don't have the money, they want to listen to you. That is not what God. Slice of you, you having money or having this before people will listen to you. God wants to listen to you. You have something to contribute. You have something to deliver. And that's why God is saying that this year, you will do something new that you have never seen before in your life. God is going to do something new. Isaiah 43 verse, from verse 18. Isaiah, are you with me this morning?
Yes,
are you here this afternoon?
Yes,
I am here to encourage you as you are here that God is going to do something spectacular in your life.
Yes.
Something superlative, fantastic in your life.
Yes.
We're going to go on this journey. I'm telling you, by the time we finish this afternoon, there will be a fire in your spirit to make you move and attain your destiny.
Yes.
The throne of God will support you.
Amen.
That God will grant you the strength to do it. Because you have determined in your heart to accept it. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the words of God. I'm talking to you. I want you to begin to receive. Amen.
Amen.
Begin to process that in your mind. Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. You must allow God to do a new thing in your life.
Amen.
See, when God is saying this, that he's going to do a new thing, say, do not remember the former things. Say, no, consider the things of old. God is serious about this. And I'm going to dwell on this so much this morning. For God to do a new thing in your life, this year, you must follow God's protocol. Tell somebody, follow God protocol. You must follow God's design plan. When God says, do not remember the former thing, you must not remember the former thing. You must let the former thing go. Amen? For God to do something new in your life. If you keep looking behind, you cannot move forward. You just have to let the past go. Now, show me your two eyes. Where are your two eyes? In front of you. God purposely designed that your two eyes should be in front of you because God wants you to see and move forward. God will have put your two eyes at your back. If your two eyes your two eyes are ahead of you in your front and God wants to move like this, and then you say, no, I'm going to put at the back. And then you are looking here, you are trying to move, you are looking here, you are trying to move. You're going to crash, right? Some people, they are exactly doing that. And they want to attain their destiny. No, it's not going to work. You cannot put the horse in front of the cart. God's protocol is this. Forget the former thing. Let somebody forget the former thing. There are people in this place today, some people are still remembering things of 10 years ago. Things of 20, when are you going to have time to plan for fusion? If you continue to dwell on the path, God is saying, the past must go with the past. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. Keep looking ahead. Show God that you are serious with His purpose. And this will help you. God will help you. If you keep looking, back, how do you want God to operate in your life? You cannot depend on the past. Past failure, past pain, insults, past engagement that are not necessary. Let those go.
Right.
I used to, you remember I told you before that there is nothing, you cannot do anything about your ancestors, those that have gone before you. But we can do a lot for our descendants. We can do a lot for our descendants, people that are coming behind us. You cannot rewrite history. If that thing has happened, let it go. Husband and wife, friends, some said I failed, and if you, and so what? You failed, you messed it, you blew it, and so what? Is that the end of the history of your life? No, it's not. You just let it go, and then you move on. Some of those things happen to you because God wants you to, to have something that you may possibly apply in the future in your life. And when those things are happening, and they happen to you,
if they have happened, there is nothing you can do about it. Just stop thinking about this person insult me, that person did it, let that go. And now I'm going to use, you know, illustration is good. I'm going to use file cabinet to explain the fact that as you are sitting here, God created you and you are loaded.
Amen.
You can remember things of 20 years ago.
Amen.
You can remember things of 30 years ago.
Amen.
You know, Bible recorded that when God created man, God breathed into man the breath of life. And man became a living soul. You are a living soul. And as well, and I want you to listen to this illustration. This is very important for me to really drag this home. This issue of you have to forget about the past. Because sometimes people say, I can still remember it. Of course. You have the capacity to remember, but you cannot forget. And what's he saying? God did not say, don't remember. You still remember. But the remembrance you are remembering is just for you to be able to just wave it and let it go. You just have to forget it and let it pass. So, as you sit down here, you have the physical body. That is your hardware. Begin to think on how computer operates for me to explain this very well to you. And as you are sitting down, you have the physical body, you have the spirit, and you have soul. You are a living soul. The Lord is your strength in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You are a living soul. And you know, your soul is the software of the hardware you carry around. This brain, your soul is the software. And right in your soul, remember, your soul contains your mind, your emotions, and your will. Hello? Are you with me now?
Yes, sir.
And I want you to understand this very carefully. You get to forget the past. Because God is emphasizing on this, because if you don't forget the past, new thing may not happen.
Right.
And he said, I'm going to do a new thing.
Right.
So you must make room for new things in your life.
Right.
So right in your soul, you have your mind, you have your emotions, and you have your will. Some of you are strong-willed people. Mm-hmm. You can use it good. You can use it to your advantage. Sometimes if you are not careful and allow the Spirit of God, it could be disadvantaged too.
Right.
Some people are so stubborn, you cannot correct them. When they determine to do something, you believe it is evil, they will go and do it, and they will damn the consequences. Of course, God has given you the power to do that. Several times I've said that. You can do anything, you have power to choose, but the consequences, you will not determine it. So that's why you got to be very careful. So now, right in your soul, that your mind, that is where I'm going, that your mind has what we call file cabinets. Files cabinet. In that file cabinet, in your mind, you have cabinet with the file of bad things people have done to you. You have the file of people that have injured you. You have the file of good things that have happened to you. You have the file of offenders. You have the file of people that have, crossed your path. You keep all these files in your mind. They are there. And let me tell you something. Your soul that contains your mind, your will, and your emotions will not die. Actually, it's not going to die. You are a living soul. Now you can tell me any soul that sinned must die. That death they are talking about is eternal death.
Right.
Your soul will be conscious in earth till eternity if you fail to give your life to Christ. And that is why if you don't give your life to Christ, you are in trouble. Big one. But if you have given your life to Christ, your soul will remain with Christ forever. When you leave this body, when people die, what happens is that their soul comes out of their body with their spirit to go back and report to God. So that software will be downloaded into another hardware that is spiritual. And you continue to live till eternity. Amen?
Amen.
And you'll be remembering all that you have done in this other hardware. This body, you remember. The Bible says, we see ourselves, we know ourselves in heaven. You remember all those good days. Amen?
Amen.
You remember when will end up with your wife, though you cannot continue to operate as husband and wife again there. But when you see each other, we will know each other. We will still keep our emotions. Because they are not going to die. Jesus said, the Bible tells me that God will wipe away all what? Tears. All tears of emotions. You see, keep those things. Amen?
Amen.
Now, how you deal with the five cabinet of your life has a lot to do with God doing a new thing in your life.
Right.
When you go into that five cabinet, your mind, as you are sitting down there, some of you are visiting your five cabinets, as you are sitting down right there. You are physically looking to those files, you try to pick them out and look what is written there, you're picking them out, you're looking to this. If somebody is walking by, say, you just remember, oh, this guy, when we leave the church, I'm still going to deal with this one.
Right.
You are thinking of that, and you are still saying, amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah, God bless you. Look, God created you to multitask. You can do so many things at the same time. As you are sitting right there, you may be in Chicago, right there physically, and you are in New York.
Right.
And your mind is shopping. Your mind is in Gisigan. Your mind is in Kansas. Your mind is shopping this. You know, your mind is even going to, trying all those dresses. As we are sitting there, And your mind is even maybe eating right now. When I get back home, I'm going to eat okra soup, I'm going to do this. And your mind is doing everything right here, right there. You have the capacity to do that. And you also have the capacity to control what is going out, what is coming in. I will get to that one. Remember, your mind is the gate, the strong gate of your destiny. And is the one to allow things in, things out. If you don't control that your mind, you may not get to your destiny. If you don't control that your mind, you may not be able to allow God to do a new thing in your life. And God is saying here, do not remember, I want to read that Isaiah again, saying that Isaiah chapter 43. Are you with me? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do not remember the former things. No, consider the things of old. Do not remember them. You have to forget them, rather. Do not remember those things. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. I don't want to confuse you. When God says you don't remember those things, it's not saying that you are not going to remember them per se, but that when you remember them, do not dwell on them or bring out that file when you are visiting the five cabinet of your mind. Do you understand now?
Yes, sir.
Because it will affect the scope of your life. It will affect the way you look. It will affect the way you hear to people. If you go in and open the cabinet of how people have insulted you, if you go in and open the cabinet of how people have dealt with you, and you are trying to take revenge, you know what? That will begin to injure you. It will begin to drag you around. The file of regrets, don't open it. Enough with regrets and tears. So when they go in and open the file of regrets, you'll begin to weep. Enough of that. Don't let it go. Don't weep of that thing. Weep not child.
Amen.
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 You read that novel?
Yeah.
Why are you weeping? When Christ died for your tears, do not weep again. And enough with regrets and tears. Move forward, God is saying. This is a miracle place. I believe in miracles, I believe in winning.
Oh, yes.
This battle, you have won it.
Amen.
You have won this battle. This is your moment.
Amen.
Seize the opportunity. Beyond disappointment, light will shine.
Amen.
Beyond failure, light will shine again.
Amen.
It has to do with how you process the information in your mind. As we are sitting down here. We go to the next one. When you open the five cabinets in your mind, if you fail to forgive people, it's a big problem. When you forgive people, forgiving people is medicinal, is healing.
Right.
When somebody offended you And every time you go to that fire cabinet, you are remembering that you don't forgive, you don't forget, you don't let go. You can injure yourself.
You're right.
It can become sickness.
Right.
And that's why it is very important that you allow God to take vengeance. Vengeance belongs to God. I will tell you this again. Forgive those who wronged you or those who offended you. Forgiveness is healing to your soul. Matthew 6:12. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. If you say, God, forgive my trespasses, you have to say, as I forgive those that trespass against me. God will help me.
Amen.
I have a lot of energy in me. It's just as if I want to impart into you this thing. I mean, if you, God is going to do a new thing in your life.
Amen.
Christian, it's not good for us not to forgive. We must have the spirit of forgiveness. If Christ can forgive us our trespasses, why can't you just forgive somebody? Do you know what we did to Jesus Christ? Do you know what we did to God? We are all criminals. We're supposed to be placed in, what do you call this, the maximum prison? In fact, we're supposed to be placed somewhere where the prison will be located inside lagoon. An island surrounded by water or surrounded by sea that you're not able to escape. And then they put you right down, that we are criminals. And now God forgive us, wipe away all our tears. Eh? By mercy and by His grace, you are here. Eh? And then you cannot forgive somebody who does maybe small thing. Look, I don't understand. I can't talk. Human beings, we are just too complex. God wants you to release your sadness.
Amen.
And receive His gladness.
Amen.
Look at Colossians 3 verse 13. Bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. Colossians 3:13. That's how to know you as a Christian. How can you be carrying around, you know, fraud of people? Some are just, their heart is so dark. They remember all those little things. I asked for water. He didn't give me water to drink. I'm going to show him. The day she need water too, I will make sure that if I'm going to give water, I will give Peter water. You have forgotten that God can turn bitter water to sweet water.
Hallelujah!
Don't do like the enemy of Jesus Christ. He has to say, I'm thirst. And when they gave him, you know, vinegar to drink, wickedness. Some of us, we are just like that. The Lord will change you.
Amen.
And do a new thing in your life.
Amen.
And people will see it and they will say, wow.
Amen.
So this person can change like this. Don't know. See, this is a new year, 2012. It's a new year. A new year must not be poisoned with old toxic things, old, you know, venom, old things. New year should be new year. Let it be brand new. Amen. Bring all those garbage from 2011 into 2012, brethren.
Right.
Tell your husband, if he's near you, please own him. Don't bring those mistakes into 2012. I'm telling my owner. Bring good things into 2012. You know, heaven will stand with you if you do that. And we fight on your behalf. If you let go, if you forgive people, heaven will stand with you. God will fight your cause.
Yeah.
Now look at life of Joseph. You studied that in Sunday school this morning. Joseph forgave his brothers. If he didn't forgive them, as a matter of fact, he won't be able to rule very well. And look at the way God dealt with those people. They didn't want to bow down. Your enemy will bow down for you.
Yeah.
They don't want to bow down. God will cause them to bow down.
Yeah.
They thought they will sell him, they will kill him, and then the dream will not come to pass. Your enemy cannot stop you. You think they can stop the plans of God for your life? All demons put together cannot stop the plans of God for your life because you carry God around.
Amen.
Greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world.
Hallelujah.
I'm not able to abundantly above all that we think or pray, and according to the power that works in us. You are not ordinary. You are phenomenal. You are superb. You have Holy Spirit. You carry God the Father, God the Son. Holy Spirit, our senior brother. You want to get me? You first walk around Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit cannot see Holy Spirit. As you are trying to get me, Holy Spirit is beating you like this. You move like this. Who is beating me? You can't see Holy Spirit. And then Jesus is watching. You don't even get to the throne of God before you are turned to powder. Allow God to deal with your enemy. You can't do it yourself. You cannot measure enough punishment to those bad people that wants you dead. Those people that want you to evaporate. They cannot stop God. If they cannot stop God, they cannot stop you. Except if you allow them. And what this message is trying to tell you, to encourage you, is that don't give time, don't allow the enemies, okay? Do not allow the enemies. Do not repay evil for evil. Understand me? Let's be holy. Let's be righteous. Let's be a decent. Don't be a carnal Christian. Be a decent Christian. Be nice to people. Be good. I don't know. If you have the opportunity to help somebody, especially those that are in the household of faith, do it. Because if you don't do it, if God is not going to do it, He will do it.
That's right.
God can use ordinary voice to do something in somebody's life.
Absolutely.
Hello?
Right.
God can just do something. He's an awesome God.
Right.
There's no stopping God.
Right.
Do not repay evil for evil. Walk straight. Walk uprightly. And keep your heart pure. Be a nice person. Heaven will stand and fight on your behalf.
Amen.
People may not, they may hate you, they cannot stop you. The Lord will order your steps to direct your path.
Amen.
And you don't need to quit because of the enemies. Don't quit. Students, don't quit.
Amen.
Because of that professor.
Amen.
Don't quit. Don't quit. Don't leave that office because of that very bad supervisor. You do know what kind of supervisor you're going to meet in another place you are doing.
Hello.
Hello. So why do you want to leave that one? Now, when you go to that fight cabinet, and back to that fight cabinet of your mind, don't forget what I told you. Your soul contains your mind, emotions, and will. Those three things. You are tripartite being, spirit, soul, and body. Your soul is tripartite too, mind, emotions, and will. Now, when you go to that fight cabinet, do you know the one you're supposed to be taking out now? The file of gratitude.
Hallelujah.
The file of thanksgiving.
Hallelujah.
Gratitude enhances God's intervention in your life.
Amen.
Gratitude guarantees blessings.
Amen.
When you are thankful to God, it's a good habit.
Amen.
Look back, stop in a while, and count your blessings. You will see a great surprise for what God has done in your life. Some of us, we like to ask, we never take time to count our blessings. When you open this file cabinet, don't forget to visit gratitude. Be thankful to God in your heart, brethren. Look, I don't know, you may have a need in your life, you may be passing through something, but God likes when we are grateful to Him. God likes when we show the attitude of thankfulness to God. It's very important. And I want us to see this story very carefully. Open your scripture with me to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17. Gratitude is good. Gratitude guarantees the move of God in our lives. It helps us to receive from God. And it came to pass as He went to Jerusalem. We're talking about Jesus here, that He passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as He entered into a certain village, there met Him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted their voices and said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on me, on us, rather." And verse 14, and when He saw them, he said unto them, go show yourself unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. Amen?
Amen.
Of that leprosy. Now, and one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God. Let us glorify the Lord for all he has done in our lives. It's very important. And fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan, a stranger, who was not part of the covenant. And that's why we have a problem. Some believers, they show more thankfulness to God than Christians, because we take God for granted most time.
It's a common thing. I drink water. What is wrong in drinking water?
Some people can't drink water easily like that. They have to pass drip into them.
What is it? Pastor.
He said, I should thank God because I'm walking. Some people cannot walk. You will not be disabled in Jesus' name. Will not carry you with a forklift in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
We need to be thankful to God. Look, even if you are lame and you are doing like this and you are walking, you should thank God. Because some people don't have legs at all. Let alone to say that we have lame leg. If your hand is like this, you should thank God, because some people don't have hands at all.
You are right.
Some will say, I got one eye. Uh-huh. Some people don't have eyes. What do you want them to say? God help us.
Amen.
Mundane complaint. Human beings, we are full of this. Let's act out of thankfulness. Look at this foreigner. This Samaritan. And Jesus answered and said, while they are not ten cleansed, but where are the nine? There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Because he was grateful to God, he got one true faith, and the other one free of charge. Hello? He was made whole. This leper, that one that came back to say, thank you, God, God, wholeness. Which means that if you put all the 10 together, 10 lepers, the difference is clear. For that one that came back and said, thank you, Lord, and glorify the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When you open that fire cabinet, show the act of thankfulness. Gratitude guarantees blessings.
Amen.
I can look. Time will fail me to prove that to you. Even human beings, somebody says thank you for what you have done. Something in your spirit want to go further to heaven. But you do one thing and then the person says, no. What is that? Let me tell you something. You are not happy because we are created in the image of God. The same thing Jesus was placing emphasis in this place, because Jesus knows that it's very important to count our blessings. Listen to me very carefully. If you show thanksgiving to God and the spirit of gratitude, God will open the floodgate of heaven.
Amen.
Blessings will rain.
Amen.
It will flow. Hey, look, it will flow. Well, you can say amen. But action and reaction, they are equal and opposite. This will happen.
Amen.
Either you say amen or you don't say amen.
Amen.
You are thankful to God, God will open the floodgate of heaven.
Amen.
And blessing will flow. It will rain on you.
Amen.
Most times, just because we come to church all the time, we sing and praise God. Haven't you seen some Christians where they are singing, praising God, and some people are dancing like this? Some will sit down, they will be spectators. As if they are in the national stadium, swooning. They will be watching. Look at this one dancing like this. Maybe he took very strong breakfast. I don't know why. Maybe he took lunch for breakfast. See them. High service. Why are you talking? Are you the only one in the church? When you are praising God, you forget about yourself. Look at David. David was dancing, was playing the harp. You know, after the harp killed, Musa. And they kept the harp in the house of Abinadab. And God was blessing Abinadab. David said, this man, you want to take this blessing? Bring the harp to the palace. And then he was dancing. He was not, he forgot about himself. When you are in the church, forget about, where's my friend? Where's my husband? For that few hours, enjoy yourself. Let God enjoy you.
Amen.
You are created for the pleasure of God.
Absolutely.
David was dancing, and Micah, his wife, the daughter of Saul, look at this king, shamelessly exposing himself before his people. Look at her and despise David. David told her, hey, come, I will tell you history. If you don't know, I will let you know. God made me king, even when your father was alive. When somebody is talking and especially your father, it's not a good woman. Some people, they will rock the boat. You mention their father, they will rock the boat. But what boat will Micah rock? He can't rock any boat because he went beyond his boundary.
That's true.
And David spoke nonsense to her. And we are told in the Bible that she was the only one who remained barren. He was barren for. Look, when you are praising God, don't worry about whatever somebody is saying. And that's why I like some of you when you are praising God here. Yeah. Oh my God. Some people when they are praising God, they didn't praise and worship. Even somebody whose feet is dead. Somebody whose leg will rise up and want to do something. Because, you know, praise is contagious. Yes. If you stand near somebody, watch out. You stand there, you see that near somebody, is doing like this. Don't let that coldness touch you. Better find somewhere here to go and praise your God. Shine in your corner.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Yes,
shine in your corner.
Hallelujah.
I love this. What are you thinking about this? Amen. I want to go to another one before. I don't know, time is running so far, but I need to do something before we go. Now, there are so many ways to show gratitude to God, rather than just coming back to say thank you. You can show gratitude to God with your tithe, or let me put it, your time, your talents, and your treasures. You can show gratitude to God by using all the talent God has given you. You can say, God, I thank you, the knowledge that you have to help the mankind. You can show gratitude to God by releasing that knowledge, releasing that wisdom. This word needs you. So don't let us hold back. Don't hold back. The other one I want to visit now, right now, which is very important, maybe when I'm done with this one, if time will permit me, we close. If you show me your friend, I can tell you your destiny. Hello?
Hi.
When we are talking here about God doing something new in your life.
Amen.
If you want God to do something new in your life, this year 2012, begin to choose your friends.
That's right.
It's very important. Because friends can influence you.
That's right.
Friends can determine your destiny. This is very important. Do not just hang around with just anybody anyhow and you want God to do a new thing. If you know that you cannot handle cash, don't be a treasurer. Hello? Because you will steal money. If you know that, you are alcoholic, don't go and have friends that are alcoholic. Or go and get a house near liquor store. If you want God to do a new thing in your life, you begin to trace your steps. Hey, brethren, I don't know if I'm talking to somebody this morning. God is about to do something new in your life.
Amen.
You need to cooperate with God.
Amen.
You get to cooperate with God.
Amen.
Choose your friend. Do not just go around anyhow. See, somebody, by the time God is going to decide to do something new in your life, people that think, God, you cannot do anything, you are nothing, you are nonsense. They don't value you, they don't even have any respect for you. Why are you hanging around with people like that? They keep saying, you are nothing, you cannot do anything, you are nonsense, you are a failure, you are this. And God is saying, you are not a failure.
Yes.
Look, do not let those people define you.
Right.
You have to influence your friends for good. Do not let them influence you for bad. encouragers. They encourage, they don't put you down. Yes, some will help you to grow more in the Lord. Why some want to drag you away from Jesus Christ? You don't want that. Any friend that wants to separate you and your husband, keep that friend away. Because what God has put together, hello? You should be, your friend should encourage mutual and good relationship between your partners, between their relationship. Good friends, we wish you well.
Amen?
You have to understand what I'm talking about. You have to believe God and do not believe those who say nothing good can come out of you. If God is saying that it's going to be a new thing, you must believe God. Do not settle for those people that think God cannot do anything in your life. As I'm preaching now, some people will be saying, see, Pastor, they preach like that all the time. God will do anything. How many times God has been talking this one? Well, if God has been talking this one before, but today, he's saying it again. It's not a man that will lie. I am saying it. By the reason of anointing over my life, God will do anything in your life. But you have to cooperate with God. You have to cooperate with God. What you settle for will rule your life. What you settle for will determine your destiny. If you settle for valley, you will remain in valley. If you settle for mountain top, you will be where you can be on the mountain top. Why do you remain in the valley? Why do you get friends that will keep you right in the valley where you're supposed to be on the mountain top and begin to see, showing the glory of God in your life? The world will see and they will glorify God. I will tell you something. Listen very carefully. Friends affect your actions. So this issue of God will do a new thing in your life in 2012 is very important to listen to this. Friends will affect your actions. We affect your wisdom, your knowledge, and infect your moods. They can make you sad. Any friend that is trying to make you sad all the time, hey, what is going on? Check it out. You have to make a change. Let that be a new thing. Some friends are very toxic. They are very toxic. They are poison. I'm very serious. I've seen many things in this world.
And I don't
know if you are seeing the same thing I'm talking about. God wants to walk with you and you have to walk with God. You have to cooperate with God. You have to do what God wants you to do. You do it as supposed to do it so that it can be as God wants it to be. And some friends are very positive. They encourage you, they encourage those new things, they nurture you. The gatekeepers. Look, friends are the gatekeepers to your mind.
That's right.
And your mind is the gatekeeper to your destiny. If you look very carefully, are you listening to me today?
Yes, sir.
Oh, listen to me.
Yes,
let me tell you, do you see the president of nations? You want to tell them they don't have influence on who will be the gatekeeper of their house? President of the United States has a lot to do. There are protocols for those that will keep his security. They cannot just bring one non-entity from Afghanistan to come and be the secret service for the president of the United States. I am not discriminating. You are president, okay, go and ask our good luck. If it is correct, we are told that Israelis, security agents, are part of people taking care of Iran. You allow people that you trust to take care of you. If you get a house, you want to get a gate man. Are you going to go put one gate man that will take your wife?
No way.
Hello?
Hi.
Or that will bring thieves into your house to rob your house?
No way.
The gatekeeper of your house, you have influence on it. Why then do you think you do not have influence on the gatekeeper of your mind?
Hallelujah.
Your friends are the gatekeepers of your mind.
Amen.
And your mind is the gatekeeper of your destiny. If you want to do a new thing, you begin to decide who must be your friends. You begin to decide what you allow to go into your mind so you can attain your destination on time.
Amen.
Very important. This is very important. And I don't know how I will explain this to you. Let us read Isaiah 43 again. See, listen, a friend advice. A friend advice, just one advice, may change the whole of your life.
That's true.
If you don't allow yourself to be to control the gatekeeper of your life, just one advice can derail your destiny. And before you come back, it will not be too late for you, Jesus' name.
Amen.
Some people are just so careless. It's your life. If you like what I'm telling you, say, hey, I'm very smart. My father taught me. If I see a bad friend, I can look me up. I can follow you, go out as your. I will not touch any adult. So if you see me, I wear iron. Look, if everybody is smoking and smoking hell, they use it. If I get there, I could never watch them. I'm not going to smoke. Okay. Let he that think he stand, take it, let's see more. When you continue to go like that, one day you want to try it. Before you know it, you will come back in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's read it again. Let's say 43 from verse 18. Do not remember the former things. No, consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. God said he will make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. We continue to wonder how that will be possible. He's God. He can do anything. God is going to repair all the stony things in your life.
Amen.
That is what he's saying. Look, you cannot use. Look, let me say something. Let me say this thing very right. Are you with me this afternoon?
Yes, sir.
We cannot use our situation to understand God. You have to use God to understand your situation. When God says, I'm going to do anything, don't begin to look at how bad your life has been and begin to use that to understand God. No! You will use God to understand your situation, because God can do anything.
Right.
With God, all things are possible.
Absolutely.
He can make crooked road straight.
Right.
He can repair all the dead. He can make dead bones to come alive. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You have to see yourself as God sees you.
Amen.
Not as people see you. People may call you so many names, whatever they like. And God says, going to repair you, will repair you. They may say, you are a sick person, you are poor, you are illiterate, you don't understand anything, you don't know how to talk. They can say, you this one, you don't know how to walk, we're going to teach you how to walk. You are in America. When you walk, you don't just walk like this. You walk attractively. Oh, you don't have to put colors. No, we cannot teach you how to. Don't take all those tags. When you take that tag, you wear all those labels around. Sick person, doesn't know how to talk, doesn't know how to appear, doesn't know how to do. Where have they been since you were born? It is now that they are seeing you, you don't know how to talk, you don't know how to walk, you don't know how to put color, you don't know how to say things, you don't know how to eat, you don't know, you have to know how to take spoons, you take your fork like this, they say, hey. Where there is spirit of God, there is liberty. Don't let people give you all those tags. See, if you allow those people to give you those tags, you wear those labels. Who are you? What is your name? That is what is important. It's not what people are calling you. If God says he's going to do a new thing, he's going to do a new thing. Believe this, brethren.
Yeah.
You just have to believe God. He's a good God. He will do it. Yeah. But you have to forget the past. When you open that cabinet, don't take all those bad cabinets. You have to see yourself as God sees you.
Amen.
Not as people see you.
Amen.
People may call you all those names. What is your name? What do you call yourself? Do not accept bad tags, okay?
Yeah.
If you do that, you go around with that. When people say you are sick, God says you are healed.
Yeah.
When people say you are poor, God says you are rich.
Yeah.
When people say you are an idiot, God says you are wise.
Yeah.
You are not a fool.
Hallelujah.
God is resident in you.
Amen.
You are not ordinary.
Amen.
Don't let people call you those bad names. So they call some people nigger. Who is a nigger? I'm a son of God.
Yeah.
I'm not a nigger. Hello?
Hi.
I am bastard. If you see my father's photo, you can see. One time, Philip was asking, show us the father. Jesus said, Philip, in John chapter 14, The first person who started that question, Thomas. Jesus was telling him, I'm going to prepare a place for you where I am with you also. Thomas was saying that, just the way. Jesus said, where? I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. If, you know, no one comes to the Father except by me. And then, Philip said, show us the Father. Jesus looked at them. And Jesus was having a discussion, his exit. He was planning to exit this world. And after he had been with them for some years, he said, Philip, since I have been with you, you are still telling me, show us the Father. Oh my God. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So you are looking for God, I'm not a bastard. Look at me, and you will see God in my life. Amen. It's going to be a new thing. I believe that. You believe in me. You're going to come with testimonies. People are going to come to this place with testimony. Saying that you're not going to make it, they will come back and be just with you. They think they're not graduating. They will come to your commencement, the beginning of your destiny. After you take that certificate in your hand like this, that diploma, say, come and see. You think I can't make it? You come and see. They said, they looked down, said, you cannot have any baby. Yeah, okay, when I'm going to do baby christening, when I'm going to do dedication, I'm going to invite you. Everybody is married, want to marry. You think you can get husband? When you are going to do your wedding, we invite them. They will come and they will see you in your white robe.
Hallelujah!
And you're mad. With your husband there, you might say, wow! So new thing can come out of this place? Your enemy will be disappointed. The mighty name of Jesus. Look, it's a good God. I love Jesus. I love Jesus. He can make a new future for you. He can make all the crooked road, make them straight for you. All that the locusts have eaten, Jesus can restore them. He will prepare your future. Fantastic. God will make those crooked places and you will be surprised. He will make an highway right in the desert.
Amen.
He's a good God. He will repeat your destiny. And bring out your dreams.
Amen.
You can repair broken life.
Amen.
This is your season, brethren.
Oh, yes.
This is your year. 2012 is your year.
Yes.
This is my year.
This is my
season. I must shine by the grace of God. Let's see Psalm 126. When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with singing. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad. That's how it's going to be for you. In 2012, the mighty name of Jesus. Bring back our captivity, O Lord. As the streams in the south, those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing seed for sowing, shall darkness come again with rejoicing. Bring his shares with him, and so shall it be for you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
I claim Psalm 126 for you. In year 2012, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
You will come forth with singing.
Amen.
You will be like, people will look at it, is this, am I dreaming?
Wow.
Who is this one?
Wow.
Let me clean my glasses. They will take off their glasses. You know, see, brethren, there's some things that people do sometimes. They think that they can change the position of God for your life. Have you seen people with magnifying lenses,
right?
When they look at an object?
Right.
So when they look at that object, it looks big, right? But does it mean that object is big?
No.
Some people are just looking with magnifying lenses, they look like glasses. They think they can change what God has done in your life. They look like this, they're thinking, they have to go and double it.
Hallelujah.
Before they can see.
Amen.
Because God will change your situation.
Amen.
You make it right in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because we are serving a living God. It's not a dead God. God is not dead, God is alive. No, I have the conviction in my heart that tomorrow is well.
Hallelujah.
Your future is in the hands of God.
Amen.
Look, I have that conviction in my heart. that God is going to renew your strength.
Amen.
You do anything in your life.
Amen.
I don't know all those things that locusts have eaten, but God is going to redeem that time.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Look at Psalm 80, verse 3. Restore us, O God. Cause your face to shine, and we shall be saved. The Lord will restore you. He will cause his face to shine upon you.
Amen.
Job 42, verse 10. And the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. Indeed, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. All that I have restored, the Lord will do it for you.
Amen.
All that enemy has taken away, the Lord will restore them back.
Amen.
Double, double portion, the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Triple, triple, the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Quiet. Don't let me continue. If I continue. Look at Job, Job chapter 8, verse 21. He will yet fill your mouth with laughing and your lips with rejoicing. That is your portion in 2012. Because this is a miracle and winner place. Miracles. You are all winners. The mighty name of Jesus. Failure will not locate you. When they are calling disaster, they will not locate you. Terrorists will not locate you. Failure will not locate you.
Amen.
Evil will look for you, will not find you.
Amen.
In 2012, you will break through.
Amen.
And your breakthrough will be pronounced.
Amen.
You see, when God blesses somebody, you cannot hide God's blessing.
Absolutely.
You try to hide it.
Never.
I don't want to make mention.
I
could have said one woman who is pregnant here should stand up and hide the pregnancy for us to see. Hello? When the pregnancy is sitting there, it's there, and you show it, you tell people, come and see what my husband did, you. Come and look at me. You don't even need to make an aspect. As they see you, they know the glory of God is in your life.
Hallelujah.
That your husband is, by the grace of God, is doing great things in your life.
Hallelujah.
When God blesses people, you cannot hide God's blessing.
That's right.
If you show, can you walk and your head will not shake? Okay, try it, walk. Walk and then walk. Is that normal? When you walk, your head must shake. You walk with God's beauty. God makes everything beautiful in his time. Let us rise. Let us begin to thank God.